managed to fly within Africa. So 5 days traveling. So he's now got to spend 7 days visiting 6 countries. So he flies into Ghana, 6 hours. Ghana is not important in the itinerary of Clinton. He flies into Uganda, and he stays 1.5 days. He spends 3 hours in Rwanda. He spends a little less than a day in South Africa. He spends a day or so in Botswana, and he just Senegal is just to stay to the airport and go. So obviously, Senegal, Rwanda, Botswana, South Africa is not important. What's important? What is happening in Uganda that Clinton was told to get over there? A conference, right? Who sponsored the conference? These 17 countries, Central African countries, sponsored the conference. The conference was sponsored by 17 Central African countries. The leading countries of the Congo, Uganda, and Rwanda. Who attended the conference? 50 ministers from every country in Africa. Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Indian, Pakistan, Iran. What's happening? Why are all of these countries coming to this conference of African people? Is there something happening here that we don't know about, we weren't told about? Clinton was told by the business establishment, you must attend this conference in Uganda. Something is happening here. What is happening? What is it that these 17 Central African countries have that the United States and the world need? Minerals. The minerals that come from the lower two-thirds of Africa. 90% of all known minerals in the world come there. If most of the minerals that you need, like cobalt, zinc, copper, platinum, they're located in different countries, but they're mainly in the Congo, Zambia, Zimbabwe, Angola, Rwanda, Mozambique, and some in South Africa. Most of the minerals at this point come through Africa through a railroad system that passed through South Africa. That's the way they set it up. It is calculated that if the minerals do not leave Africa, that Western Europe will economically collapse in 6 months. Japan, 6 months. United States, less than a year. You can't make a computer, a fax machine, a rocket. You can forget it. So that means that those or who controls the natural resources are what? They are the key players in the world's what? Economy. See, you play with the stock and bonds, give me some cobalt, some diamonds, some nickel to make the world run. Who used to control these? You used to have to come to the United States and England. But who now controls it? Africans. But let us go on to try to answer the question, do we hopefully control it? When South Africa was here, South Africa was running border raids across the South African and destroying everything in Angola, Botswana, Zimbabwe, Zambia, and Mozambique. Kept everything destabilized, right? Mobutu, with the West, had a war going into, was keeping Congo Brazzaville under the French, had a war going into, you get Sudan, had a war going into Uganda, was an integral part of Rwanda. Did we kill, could we have killed a million in less than 6 months? Or what drug warfare or European genocidal policy was put in Rwanda? Let us not believe that we killed all those people. They had a war going in, you know, Savimbi in Angola, right? So two-thirds of Africa was kept in a virtual state of war. Now, if you were in a state of war, you can't get together. Plus, they had stripped your country because the Germans control one-fifth of the Congo, and they were stripping everything they could. So we were in pretty bad shape. Angola was the only country in the southern African region that could challenge South Africa because Angola had oil. And with oil, you can buy what you want. So Angola, because of its population and the oil, was a threat to South Africa because they could buy tanks, airplanes. So United States and the West policy was to have South Africa constantly strike Angola from the south. And Savimbi would come from the Congo and strike them from the north and keep Angola destabilized. They had the civil war in Angola and a group got in that wasn't favorable to the United States. They really pushed in against them. Angola was almost toppled. The Russians did not help Angola. For some reason, the OAU didn't help Angola. And Nigeria didn't help Angola. Who helped? Juba came in, stabilized the situation with weapons, with 50,000 plus troops, with tanks, airplanes, etc., right? In 1990, they had a big war in the southern part of the Congo, of Angola, and Alambe shows you the picture. Kunta Kinabalu is when the African Angolan and the African Cuban destroyed 100,000 men of the best white army they could put there. That's South Africa, that's Israel, that's France, and their best. We destroyed them. When we destroyed them, they were going to push into South Africa. But America and them said to Angola and Cuba, can we make a deal? And they said, okay. The agreement was that Angola and Cuba would not push into South Africa. But the condition was they had, South Africa had to release Namibia on the road of independence. That's how Namibia got independent. And that South Africa had to do what to all political prisoners? That's how Mandela and everybody got out. They didn't get out because of sanctions or because of your demonstration. It's because of this agreement. And that South Africa had to be put on the road of independence. That's how they got. So what they did was they stopped the whites from all of these countries all of a sudden were brought to a state of peace. So once when you stop fighting, you can talk. But meanwhile, you have this problem here. So when you first heard of Kabila moving across, now you know that the United States and NATO intervened about 3 or 4 times to stabilize Mobutu. But when you heard them moving, there was no NATO intervention. Then the United States says that the Congolese troops were not winning the war on their own, they had help. That was to admit that they couldn't do it on their own, and then they held back. Because that was an admission that the Congolese troops were getting help, right? So what they found out later, that what troops combined to get rid of Mobutu? Angola, troops, tanks, planes. Uganda pushed in, troops, tanks, planes. 17 countries pooled their resources to get rid of Mobutu. Africans were working on a pan-African relationship. Who supported this move? Sudan, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Zambia, Zimbabwe, Tanzania, and Uganda, and Angola, and Congo. The Africans were on the move. That's why they didn't intervene, because they knew what was going to happen. Because the whites already were destroyed here, and you know what we did to them up in Somalia. They knew they could not intervene against that powerful military force, and they swept them out. It is these 17 countries that collectivized their energies to get rid of Mobutu are now in a regional economic bloc. And it is these 17 countries who a regional economic bloc will call a conference. They say they're no longer Francophone or Frenchmen. They're no longer Anglophone. They are Bantuphone. Okay? And as a result of this military victory, with these countries pooling their resources, that's why these natural resources are under your control. Kabila has traveled to Switzerland, probably to work out something with the Swiss to get back some of the money from Mobutu. He has been to Japan, China, Korea, making their arrangement, but he has not gone to Western Europe. He has not gone to America. So now America's complaining that they can't establish a relationship with him. But why is it critical? Because if you want cobalt for your jet engines, you want diamonds, you got to deal with them, but now you must come to Africa under the terms of these countries. So Clinton was sent there specifically to go there to beg. Okay, he was begging. Because they don't have to deal with them, because whatever you need in the world, you can get from other people. But the United States could not have you see that Clinton was sent just to Uganda. So they had to make it sound as if he was on this African tour. You know how they disguise it? And so he can drop into Angola or Uganda and try to check out what's happening. But of course they had to know his thing with all these black folks, wrangle and wrestle, the smoke screen. Yes. So it is these two events. Cuba was the pivotal country to get Angola, the dominant military force here, which then led to this additional force to do this. And if you listen to the foreign minister of Angola and the Congo and the rest of them, you will see why these are under their country. So now, as we conclude, you now have Angola with about 250,000 men under arms. The Congo said they're going to put 250,000 men under arms. Ethiopia, whatever they have, 50,000 men under arms. Nigeria, about 200,000 men under arms. And Egypt has about 200,000 men under arms. Now, I don't know about South Africa because they're still under white control, so I don't count them. So you can see we're beginning to be well armed. So there should be no more intervention in it. And how do you know? It's because the foreign minister of Congo told you at the UN that they are not going to allow Savimbi to operate. They're going to get him. 5,000 troops from Angola crossed the Congo and stopped the civil war in Congo-Brazzaville. Nigeria, with Ghana, sent in troops to stop the civil war in Liberia and to stop the civil war in Sierra Leone. So what you're now having is African regional power taking care of their own problems. And now they begin to regionalize along economic blocks so that they're first trading among themselves, and they're working with the rest of the world, and they primarily bypass the United States of Europe. And later on another time, I'm showing the articles where United, where the IMF is going to suspend the Congo from the IMF because they want the Congo to pay them $14 billion that Mobutu and they stole. And Kabila and them already said, look, when you find the money that you stole with Mobutu in your banks, you give it to us, and we'll give you back some. And Kabila wants to know, where are all the roads and stuff that you this money that you loan with him? Where, show me. You loan with him. Where, show me. going to hide, they're going to take the local people, they say in conjunction with the chiefs, and they're going to rebuild the roads, they're going to give the people axes, picks, shovels, and they're going to pay them. So they're going to rebuild the road system without a dime from the IMF. So this is how they're beginning to break the lead. And with you controlling the natural resources, you no longer have to come to anybody for anything. And the world has radically changed. And this is where we are progressing and we're moving. And these are some of the basic facts and understanding that we have to assess where we're going. And when you listen and you hear that Nigeria is beginning to build a pipeline all across West Africa, Togo, Benin, Ghana, Ivory Coast, and what it's going to do is going to make it possible for you to begin to industrialize. And here, the New York Times, they talk about Nigeria. With all of the internal problems, and they're talking about Nigeria, the regional power that will help to bring a regional economic order to that part of the world. We got problems, we're going to work it out. But we got people, we got natural resources, we got oil and fuel. So when they lay down that pipeline across West Africa and they start the industrial process, Nigeria is richer than South Africa. It's just that in South Africa, they developed it. They just didn't even touch what's in Nigeria. So what's coming is the fact now that Nigeria has replaced the English and the Americans. And I'm going to read you just one short paragraph from here. And it says here, the international West Africa trembles with Nigeria. 2 minutes and we're finished. The international commitment. No fewer than 7 African head of states rushed to Nigeria when Abacha died. South African Egypt may have more of a powerful army, but no African, now this is from the white man, okay? This is his their assessment, and you assume that this is they want to be as negative as they could. South African Egypt may have a more powerful army than the African, but no African country is more involved in the security arrangement in the surrounding regions than Nigeria. South Africa may have a higher level of industrialization and a teeny oil state of Libya and Gabon, much higher per capita income, but no African country's economic wealth is more vital to its neighbors. Nigeria is the engine. You destabilize and break it up, we all gonna be in trouble in Africa, in West Africa. It has to stay as a unit, but they got to work it out among themselves, how it's going to be run. But it, as a nation state with the power to do what it has to do in West Africa, economically, militarily, and the world, it has to stay intact. Oil-rich Nigeria can submerge its neighbors in economic woes or flood it when it is flush. It's the world's 7th oil producer and the United States' largest trading partner. Only African countries whose sudden disappearance from the map would cause more than a momentary ripple on the international scale. They say Nigeria is important to the world. 105 million people, large military, and a hyperactive foreign policy that many would quibble with America's self-designation. The president of Sierra Leone, 1,000 miles from Nigeria, to west of Nigeria, was overrun in a coup. 13 months ago, I took this out of the Times today. We're overrunning the coup 13 months ago by rural rebels who invaded the capital, Freetown, looting and burning all in his path. Washington quickly sent Marines to evacuate Western residents, saving them from the mayhem and doing nothing to help the country. The United Nations, likewise, took no action. The only country that provided willing and able to help out the floorless nation was Nigeria. General Abacha sent warships to blockade the rebels, and trying to starve the economy. War planes to bomb the insurrection. Well, when all of that did not work, he mounted an intervention force. Nigerians lost troops, but he restored the order and stability. Sierra Leone president, etc., went on to say, there's going to be no change in the foreign policy of Nigeria, according to the new president. When there is trouble in our region, this is Abacha, whatever. because to go absent would mean letting the fire spread. And it goes on and on and on and on. And this is